Oh, very recently, actually, about 4 years ago, yeah.
Well, you mentioned going to school and the importance of education, the value placed on that. And of course, that's for all of us who've had a colonial or post-colonial, quote unquote, education, it's a very mixed bag, isn't it? You know, we've benefited in a way from some of the advantages given to a few, but it also means a kind of process of questioning that education. So I actually wanted to ask you about what you have described as cultural imperialism. Before we come to present day, continuity of cultural imperialism, but the older one, when you were in school, when you were in that college, which sounds very much like St. Stephen's in Delhi, a kind of a privileged place where a lot of very talented people met.
Yeah, I went to my school was called Alliance High School, and it was really, schools in Kenya, by the way, segregated. There were schools for Europeans only, schools for Asians only, and schools for Africans only. And Alliance High School was one of the most elitist of for Africans only. Yeah. It was a boarding school, and for me, it became like some kind of refuge from the war going on. I felt when I was inside the school, I could more or less shut off the cries of going outside, the bullets, the sound of bullets, the screaming there. But every time I left the place and went back to the village, I'd experience the reality of what the villagers were experiencing. And I remember one time after first term in this boarding school, I returned home. I done quite well in the school, in the Alliance High School, first term. And my mother was really very influential in my education. I'll talk about her a little bit later. Was a very big impact on my life. So I wanted to go home and show her my results, okay, or whatever I done. Let me just describe this a little bit because it didn't make sense until. What happened was this, it's my mother who first sent me to school, okay. She could not read or write, all right? But she's the one who supervised my homework. She bought my first set of uniform, shorts and shirts, school. And she supervised my homework. And every time, but since she could not read or write, she did by asking me questions, how I had done in school and so on. And I remember once, blurting out, I got 10 out of 10. And she says, is that the best you could have done? and then another time I come back to be more emphatic. I say I got 100%. Igana kwa igana. And the same question, is that the best you could have done? So, when I went to high school, I was thinking, my mother might, if I go back, I wanted to tell her the results, but in my mind I was thinking, I could anticipate the question, was that the best I could have done? So I'm enjoying this encounter with my mother and so on. So I go to the village where I was, and I find my house was no longer there. The entire village had been burnt down, erased. It's like met with desolation. It's horrible. And I did not know anybody. I didn't know what had happened. Because letter writing in those days was very minimal. It's not like today where you have these things, these magical, the magical thing I see all you carrying. Why you do like this? And then you talk. You actually, no, I don't digress, but it's very funny. Because, like Neil, when I first saw those things, people going about, they are alone, and they are talking. And sometimes I didn't say, he's alone, because they put those, some of those things here, and they are alone, and then you see them laughing. Or, in one case, very angry, you know, somebody. Now, with those technology, if you saw someone doing like that, talking to themselves, or being angry or laughing by themselves, you'd think they were mentally challenged. But now, you know, everybody, I suppose, is mentally, not challenged, but mentally, whatever. Yeah. So we didn't have those kind of things in those days. So I go back and it's raised to the ground, and only later do I discover, I go looking for, until I found a person who told me, no, they have gone to a new village, a concentration village. They were forced to leave their old villages and go into a concentration village. Again, that desolation is part of me, and is actually central to my other memoir called In the House of the Interpreter.
In addition to this physical desolation, there is also, what shall I say, a kind of cultural desolation that is the result of, you speak about, I think this is something all Indian students will identify with, reading about daffodils and, you know, remember we were talking about what our first impressions of England was when you finally went there. So that kind of having to remember what you said.
But let me be clear. When you were going through it, it did not sound like cultural desolation. It was very nice going around talking about daffodils and, you know, and talking about snow, and you know, we've not seen snow except on Mount Kenya. So in a way, it didn't come across as desolation in that sense, you know. It came across as, now we are very learned.
A disconnect.
Yeah.
Because, you know, in India, if you read about rain being terrible, you don't really understand.
You
don't understand, because we wait for the rain.
You're just seeing it. Mm. You just, as you know, as primary school, you'd sing, Rada is bana, Rada is bana, roko rwada, roko rwada. That's learning is burning. Rada, Rada is bana, Milan is bana, because that's how the sounds came across to us. As Rada is bana, Rada is bana, Roko Rwanda.
Well, actually, once I saw a little video of neoliterates, adult literacy classes in Kerala, I think, and they were being, you know, taught things like, you know, London Bridge is falling down and so on. Mm-hmm. So yeah. this continues.
Yeah. London Bridge, House of Parliament. Actually, now that you talk about it, there's a textbook we used to read, English textbook, I still remember. Because it was Oxford Readers for Africa, and the two characters, John and Jane.
That's right.
And they went to...
we all know them.
They went to Oxford. And they live either in London or the other way around, you know. They went to a place called Reading, but they also went to school in Oxford. And they took trains. And one day they went to Thames, to London, and London Zoo, and House of Parliament. But I had never seen them. Yeah. But those characters, John and Jane, became actually real characters, you know, Jane and, you know. So when I first went to England and I went looking for where Jane and... Where's Jane? Where's John? Where did they go?
Probably in Africa.
Yeah, they're probably in Africa. Uh-huh. Yeah. So it did not really come across like this at the time. It's only when you have to reflect upon it years later, you understand what was happening to you, right? So reflection years later is what made me wait a minute. How come, what was really, when you can't think of it, what's happening when you teach a child that environment of England or Germany is more real to them than the environment of their surroundings. What does it mean to make a child, first of all, know all the names of the rivers of Europe and the mountains there, and not start with the rivers around them? It's as if the rivers of Europe are more rivery, more rivarious.
Yes.
Or other, you know.
But in addition to the physical characteristics, there's also the colonial experts on the native mind. And you've spoken of having to read literatures, all of us, where others, for example, Isaac Dennison, you've mentioned, Karen Lixon, in Out of Africa, how she sees Africa, a rather zoological view, because she says that the big game explains the African mind.
What she
to
says,
her.
What I like, I remember the phrase in Out of Africa, what I learned from the game of Africa was later very useful to me when I came to contact with the Africans. In other words, to understand the African mind, she was helped by her understanding of animals. But let me go back to this question of rivers. It's very important because essential is also part of the whole system of alienating the colonial child from his base, from environment, right? Education knowledge begins where we are. Knowledge, in fact, begins with our body, literally, right? And then, you know, like a child, you know, because by understanding sort of mothers, you know, this part of the mother, because of the milk she drinks from there, you know, sometimes, you know, their ears and so on. Sometimes children, sometimes, initially they don't even think that this is part of them, so they bring something here, might do like that. Then later they are, oh, it's part of my ear, and so on. And you go on adding, knowledge, because knowledge is no more than the idea of knowing. So you start from here, you go there, you go on adding, and so on. That's very important as a process of knowledge, process of knowing, okay? But when you tell, or you make a mistake, that knowledge begins not from you and what's around you, but begins from elsewhere. So in that sense, Europe more or less becomes the beginning of knowledge. It's like the education system is asking you to see yourself with the eyes of an outsider, right? To place yourself in Europe and then see yourself sort of backwards, okay? Instead of the other way around, where you begin where you are, you go on adding